In the modern world of data, using the data type of JSON is absolutely critical, especially when you're working with big data sets. And in this video, we'll look at the ways that Snowflake allows you to work with this data type and hopefully make your life much easier. One of the most common things you'll run into is arrays. So that's the first thing we'll look at. Snowflake allows you to parse through JSON arrays directly by simply traversing through the object. So in our case, our column name is JSON. We're calling from this table and we're saying right here, root. The object in the array obviously starts at 0, meaning the first one. And there is only one root object, so 0. Then the children, which is another array. And we're saying, give me 0, which is the first one, and the name values. We would expect to see Jane here. And then in this one over here, we're saying cities lived, and the first one in that object, which would be the place, which would be Seattle. So let's see what happens. And that's what we get. We get Jane in Seattle, just like we expected. You'll notice a difference here. This result has quotations. This one does not. One tip that you can do to clean up your JSON results is to cast it as a particular data type. You can do this across Snowflake in different places, but I think when working with JSON specifically, it's really helpful. So by adding this here, it gets rid of those quotations and lets Snowflake know that this is expected to be a string. If we do the same here, we now see the same happened here as well. Next up, we're gonna look at a useful function that is the flatten function in Snowflake. And what this will do is separate these events into individual JSON objects while preserving the global data. It returns a row for each object. We're going to get a new row for every object in an array. And the syntax for joining this onto your original table, this is the table that we have with the JSON object, right? If we add a comma and then use the term table, and we're joining another table that is going to be that flattened result set. So we're taking that flattened out version of the JSON object, saying this is a table, and we want to have that table attached to this original data set. The term value here will give us the result of this table. And really all it's going to do, as we can see here, is put us down one level from where this is. So if we look at the original, this is, you know, root and everything within it. And now the value of this is essentially the same thing, just without the root object. So we've moved down one level. And in a second here, we'll see how that can be useful in other ways. Now, just like up here, where we extracted the value from the object with colon and parsed it through here, we can do a similar thing here. We're saying value, which is the result of this flattened join, give me full name. So we're looking in our details and saying, in here, give me full name, give me this value. And because this is flattened out, it will do this for every single record that it sees. So we should expect the value John Doe, Mike Jones, and I think there's one more, and Anna. So we should see those three. And here we do. Now this is repeated, the actual JSON value, but we were able to identify those individual values by flattening that object and then parsing out the value. We could do something like this, cast it as a string and give it an alias. Let's see how this looks. There we go. So now we have some data that we can work with that we've parsed out through a JSON object. Even though we're only going down one level, as we just saw with the flattening, you can add another one again based on that previously flattened value. In this case, our first level got rid of the root, so we're just looking at everything here, you know, everything below it. If we say flatten the value of children, that is going to be every value of this for each record. So we have this one, we'll have these, and I think that's it. So we would expect to see all of those results in terms of this value. So before there was only one value because we only had one flattened table. Here we have two, we've aliased them, and we can get that value here, and we should see it completely laid out for us. And here we go. So this is the original level that we've been working with. And then the children list just flattened out there for us. You know, if this was all we were concerned with, we could do something like this. Then maybe even parse out the name. There we go. Next up, we'll look at the parse JSON function. Okay, so parse JSON is very subtle, and essentially it's telling Snowflake that we want the actual value in the JSON object. So if you remember, most of the objects were returning with those quotations. We were doing that string cast workaround to get that value. What we can do instead is say parse JSON and then the value. So let's look what happens here if we do something without the parse JSON and with it. So here, right away, even though this is an integer, the original one here is being wrapped in the quotations, whereas parse JSON, it picked it out. An important difference is when you start to work with nulls. And nulls in JSON can be slightly different than in other areas. If you have a value that is this in your JSON object, that will return as null in Snowflake here. This would return as null. And as would something that had no value. If there was no value whatsoever, similar to in this case, there is no value for children for the third option, which is Anna. It's null, and that is returning as null. Don't worry about this one. This is bringing in the other table, which we don't actually care about here. Not related to this example. But the main point is that if you had a JSON object that said something like name, and then a value of null like this within these, that would be returned as a null here as well through parse JSON. It would recognize that that's what that's supposed to be, as would if there was nothing. That part's a bit tricky, but just something to keep an eye on as you start to work with parse JSON more in depth. And finally, there is the getPath function. And getPath is essentially going to return the value of whatever path you put in. So in this case, we're looking at our sample here. We're looking here and saying, give me the value of root 0 full name, which would be root first object and the first full name, John Doe, and then gender. So we would expect to see John Doe male return because we're giving that path here. And I'm just going to filter out fluff here. And here we go, John Doe male, just like we expected because it's looking at this path. This is expecting valid JSON in this object right here. But if it is, you can get a value by simply putting it in like that. I guess there's certain scenarios where you would want to do that. I think using some of these other functions is easier, but to each their own, and I'm sure there's different scenarios where that might make more sense. That'll do it for this video. I wanted to do a brief overview on how you can use JSON in Snowflake, because if you're a full-time engineer or anyone working with significant data sets, you're definitely going to run into this, and it's important to know. Thanks as always for watching. Please feel free to like, subscribe, comment if you have any questions, and I'll see you at the next video. Thanks.